Netflix's new show Yasuke is loosely based on the historical figure who served under the rule of the 16th century feudal lord Oda Nobunaga.
Fatal technique.
It has drawn comparisons to 2007's Afro Samurai, which is set in a futuristic Japan that's both technologically advanced and operates under a feudal system. But Yasuke's creator, LaShawn Thomas, who is known for shows like The Legend of Korra and Black Dynamite, says the only real similarity to his show and Afro Samurai is both depict a black samurai warrior.
I thought Afro Samurai was an incredibly entertaining story. But it's different from what we're making. You know, Afro Samurai was fictional. Afro Samurai was a sort of self-insert. You know, it was inspired, to my knowledge, by Soul Train, disco, black culture, afros, and hip-hop. That was what the creator said it was his inspiration was. It wasn't Yasuke. Yasuke is inspired by an actual person who served one of the three unifiers of Japan. So just by that very nature, it's going to be different, you know, regardless of whether you like it or not.
Recording artist Flying Lotus is behind the show's music, and he's much more bold in his criticisms about Afro Samurai.
Yasuke, the legendary black samurai.
I think Afro Samurai was good for what it was at the time, and I think it was like hot off of like the Tarantino hype from Kill Bill, and I think that that worked for what it was. But I think, you know, in terms of like a story, like a real plot line and stuff, like Yasuke has that, has some heart. And I don't really think there was much heart in Afro Samurai, but yeah, I you know, they set a tone, right? They're can't diss them or whatever, but our show is better. Sorry.
The art and character design of Yasuke came from the Japanese animation studio MAPPA and earned critical praise. The handling of the titular character, however, received mixed reviews. On Rotten Tomatoes, Yasuke got 92% positive reviews from the critics, even though almost half of the fans panned it, such as this Twitter user who complained it's as if the true story of a black slave who becomes a samurai wasn't interesting enough and needed robots and werebears.
Joining me now from Tokyo is the author of Japanamerica, Roland Kelts. Hi there, it's good to have you with us today. So, as we've just said, Yasuke got mixed reviews, and most of the people who criticized it say that they would actually like to get to know Yasuke, the character, more. So, what do you think in that sense? Was it pleasing enough for you? Were you happy?
I was happy with parts of it. I think the animation in particular is really good. It's really high quality animation. And I think the character is very rich. I think probably why that's a complaint is that the character is so well introduced that the audience wants to know more.
Okay, so for example, there are a handful of flashbacks in the show that highlight the key events of Yasuke's time as a samurai, but then the most of it is really based on an original plot that, you know, takes place years after, you know, Yasuke's events. So do you see that, for example, as perhaps the reason why people weren't satisfied enough with Yasuke's being the highlight?
Well, to be fair, the artist didn't have much to go on. There just isn't that much historical material available. We're talking about 16th century Japan. So they tried to bring in a lot of fantastical elements, elements of mecha anime or giant robot anime, fantasy, science fiction. And I think for the most part, they succeed. Again, I think one of the complaints about Yasuke is that the character is so interesting that people want to know more.
Okay, so you mentioned the fantasy elements. Can you please tell us more why you think that part of the show was a success?
You're talking about generations now of fans all over the world. You know, maybe 40 years ago, most of the fans were in Japan and in Asia. And now you're talking about fans in the United States, other parts of North America, other parts of the Middle East. Certainly you have a huge fan base in Latin America now. And so those generations of fans know anime. So that means that the artist can introduce anime about anime, kind of meta anime. So the fantastical elements, the science fiction elements, they often refer quite cleverly to earlier forms of anime, and that's very appealing.
Okay, so you brought up an interesting point, actually. Do you draw a line between animes that are, you know, watched and favored in Japan and outside Japan? I mean, is there a huge gap there?
Well, the gap is getting smaller because so many international streaming services like Netflix, Amazon, they have offices in Tokyo. So they're actually very close to what's happening in the Japanese industry, and more Japanese artists are aware of a global audience. So there is a line. I wouldn't say I draw too sharp a line anymore. I think that line is blurring, but I think there will also be always be certain anime programs that are made in Japan for Japanese exclusively. And I think there's a growing genre of anime products that are made for a global audience with international artists creating them and international fans in mind.
Mm. I think the reason why I'm asking this question is that there is, you know, a growing concern, I'd say, that, you know, Netflix productions or, you know, global animes, let's say, would be watered down or, you know, too American or, you know, de-Japanized or, you know, lose its originality and authenticity. Do you see this to be the case, and does this concern you?
I think to some extent it will be the case, but to be honest, it doesn't concern me very much. And the obvious comparison, I suppose, is with sushi. Today, there's sushi called California roll. There are all kinds of variations on sushi around the world that are not arguably authentic sushi. At the same time, you can come to Tokyo, you can come to any part of Japan, really, and sit down and get authentic sushi whenever you want. And you can get authentic sushi at some restaurants outside of Japan. So I think the two can coexist without a zero-sum game. I don't think one is going to destroy the other.
Okay, so Netflix is launching 40-something original animes, you know, this year. So they're really betting big on anime. Do you see this to be a wise move by the company then?
Absolutely. For a couple of reasons. One, the anime audience is growing, and it's growing internationally. It's growing across ethnic and racial categories and gender categories. So in every direction, anime is growing as an attractive medium. And at the same time, to be honest, it's fairly cheap to make. I wrote about this in Japanamerica, my book, but it's very low overhead. So the cost of making a new anime production compared with the cost of a Pixar or Disney feature or any kind of live action production is dramatically lower. So for a streaming company, to co-produce anime is very cheap, and the payoff can be huge, especially when you talk about a medium that can cross international borders so easily. And anime is attractive partly because the characters are illustrated. So as long as they speak your language, they feel like yours.
Mm-hmm. Okay, speaking of other animes as well, how do you compare Yasuke with Afro Samurai? Because obviously it comes to mind, you know, this comparison. Would you say that they are actually, you know, comparable?
I think the comparison is very complementary for both titles. Afro Samurai was the creation of a Japanese artist, Bob or Takashi Okazaki. He's a manga artist who grew up admiring black culture and black pop culture. What he created and what the producers of the anime Afro Samurai created was kind of a pastiche. And I say that in a complimentary way. It's a pastiche of Japanese historical tropes like samurai dramas, a pastiche of American kind of cowboy action films, and a pastiche of what we'd call blaxploitation, you know, a kind of comedic, self-referential look at black culture. I think, you know, we're talking about over a decade later with Yasuke. Yasuke is based on a historical story. The creator of and the director of the program is a black man from the South Bronx in New York City. Several of the artists who work on the production are Black, and the animation team is Japanese. So it's something that I think builds on Afro Samurai, but has much more authenticity, certainly when it comes to Black culture, and also when it comes to Japanese history. Afro Samurai was pure fiction.
All right, Roland Kelts, it was lovely having you with us today. Thank you.